Let's look at what kind of error is introduced when we store a real number as a floating point number. So let's assume that the number we start with is a positive real number, and that number can be expressed in terms of a bunch of binary digits after the period, times 2 to some exponent, and we're going to assume that that number is normalized so that the first binary digit is equal to 1. And again, we're starting with a number that's positive, and therefore we can do that normalization. If we then only have t binary bits to use to store this number, then the natural thing to do is to either truncate or round. And we're going to truncate because that's a little bit easier to analyze. So if we truncate, then we're going to only store the first t bits and the exponent. And the question then becomes, what kind of error do we introduce when we do this? Well, we can take the floating point number that we created and subtract it off the real number to come up with the difference. And notice that you end up with t zeros and then the rest of the binary digits times 2 to the exponent. Now, what we're interested in is what the relative error is in the number that gets stored. So we're interested in delta chi divided by chi. Now, delta chi we can bound by noticing that whatever number we have here is certainly less than or equal to this right here, except with this last zero replaced by a 1. And if you work it out, that number is just 2 to the minus t power times 2 to the exponent that we started with. All right? So that we get right here. And then chi, we can get bound below by observing that the point 1 here really means 1 half because it's a binary digit. So we get 1 half times 2 to the e. And when we place that right here, then we have a bound on the relative error in chi. And if you work that out, you get that that's 2 to the minus t minus 1, quantity t minus 1. Okay, now, we'd like to somehow manipulate this expression into something that also works when chi is equal to 0 or when chi is negative. So let's rewrite this as delta chi is bounded by 2 to the minus quantity t minus 1 times chi. And notice that if chi is actually equal to 0, then the floating point number that we store is the floating point number that represents 0, and therefore we introduce no error, and therefore this inequality works when chi is equal to 0 as well. All right? And obviously, if chi is negative, then we can do a similar analysis, and then we can just put absolute values around all of this. Now this number right here then characterizes what kind of relative error is introduced. And that number is often referred to as the machine epsilon. Sometimes it's called the unit roundoff. And that machine epsilon depends on a lot of things. For example, had we rounded instead of truncated, then our machine epsilon would have become 2 to the minus t instead of 2 to the minus t minus 1. Had we stored decimal digits instead of binary digits, then the analysis would have been similar, but a slightly different machine epsilon would have come out. So the machine epsilon characterizes the machine on which you work. And in particular, it also characterizes what precision you're using. Because the machine epsilon for single precision is roughly 10 to the minus 8th. And what does that mean? That means that when you use single precision numbers, when you store them, you store roughly the first 8 most significant decimal digits. Okay? The machine epsilon, when you use double precision numbers, is roughly 10 to the minus 16th. What does that mean? That means you have 16 decimal digits of accuracy. Now, these days, actually, people are starting to talk about using half precision. They're starting to talk about using only 16 bits to store floating point numbers. And what that would mean is that you only get, well, maybe 4 digits of accuracy. And for some machine learning applications, that's good enough.